Hey, praise the Lord, everybody. So I'm coming to my family at the Willow Creek Retirement Living Center, and I just wanted to say greetings, and I'm praying that God would bless you and keep you during this time of the COVID-19 when we're just all trying to make do with what we have. And I look forward to the time to where that we can get back together again and we can meet in person. I want to go to the scripture today and share a short thought with you on out of John 16 and verse 32. The Bible says, "Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that you shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I am not alone, because my Father, the Father, is with me." Verse 33 says, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." I know that you have this experience in that God has helped you to become overcomers. But if you find yourself in a place today to where that you're not feeling the love, so to speak, you're just not feeling yourself, you're not up, or maybe you're in a place to where you need to hear from God. You've been feeling like that. And you want to hear from God today. Well, I've come to tell you that God has a word for you today. Amen. And that He is with you. God is not against you. He is with you. My title today is going to be the last lecture. This was borrowed basically from the title was borrowed from a professor who lived right here in Chesapeake. His name was Randy Posh, and he was a professor at the Carnegie Mellon University and was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer and given only 3 to 6 months to live. It is noteworthy that pancreatic cancer is one of the worst cancers that you can actually get today. And so he had just purchased his house in Chesapeake and was intending to move his entire family here. Professors are sometimes asked to give lectures on what wisdom they would impart if they knew that this was their last opportunity to do so. What he did not realize was that his last lecture would be something far beyond what impact he wanted to leave on his students, something far beyond that he wanted to leave for his students, but rather he would have an impact and something to say to the next generation where his kids would grow up without him. And so Dr. Posh, then a computer science professor, accepted the challenge. And once he learned that he only had about 3 to 6 months to live, he hesitated at first, but then he went ahead and did the lecture. On September 18th of 2007, his intention was to have fun and to advise others to do the same. And he spoke of the importance of a childlike wonder, which when he spoke of the importance of a childlike wonder, that really made me think about the importance of having childlike faith. The Bible says, unless we become as little children, we shall not enter into the kingdom of God. And one of the things we have to do is we have to have faith and believe that God is able. I remember we were praying for Sandy Buchanan, I believe that's correct. If I got Sandy's last name wrong, I apologize. But she was facing a diagnosis to where that sometimes we just got to go back and say, hey, God's big enough, God's able, and He's going to deliver me. And so I'm still believing that, and I'm meaning to get in touch with Meredith to ask about Sandy. But he wanted to emphasize the childlike wonder. So, you know, I want to encourage you not to lose that childlike wonder, a childlike faith, because even as we grow older, we are still God's children. And we need to remember that. We need to remember that no matter what, we are his baby girl or his little boy. And that never changes in his eyes. Even though we get older and we see ourselves differently, God does not see us differently. And so when you're looking at this, Dr. Posh, however, did not omit things that would just about break anybody's heart. And so he spoke of his love for his wife, which I believe is J.I. And he spoke of their three young children, saying that he had made this decision to speak mostly to leave them a video memory. I believe there's something powerful about video legacy. People being able to see your face, being able to hear your voice, even long after we're gone. I think that's very important. And so to leave a message, if you will, to the next generation. And so he wanted to put himself And sorry about that. He wanted to put himself in a metaphorical bottle that they might someday discover on a beach. And so as the video of his lecture spread across the web and was translated into many languages, Dr. Posh became the co-author of a best-selling little book called His Last Lecture. And it made him a Lewis Gehrig-like symbol of the beauty and the briefness of life. And it drew the attention of a nation. And as of when I was actually looking at this, he had had well over 18 million views, which I'm sure it's probably even far beyond that now, because this message and what he did and the message resonates. I remember that Carrie and Terry Shook, I believe is their names. They wrote a book, What If book. What if you only had 30 days to live? What would you do with that time? And but the thing about it is that with us today, we're looking at a lot of elders, a lot of people who have lived their lives and have come. And this is a retirement setting. But I want to encourage you that even though you're in a retirement setting, I don't want you to sit back, as it were, and just feel like, okay, life's done with me, life's over, because that couldn't be farther from the truth. God has chosen you. And when he chose you, every day that he gifts to you, he not just gives, but that he gifts to you. That's with a T, G-I-F-T-S, that he gifted to you. What you need to understand is that that day is full of purpose. That day is full of the pleasure and the plan of God, and he wants to do good and bless you. It doesn't matter if the suffering of our bodies we're struggling with that, because through suffering, Jesus became the captain of our salvation. So through suffering, I draw nigh unto God, because he is my only hope. There is a point, and maybe some of you have reached it, to where medicine can't help. And now you have to rely on faith. That's where our relationship with God enters into a new dimension. And it's called the dimension of promise. That's where we have to rely on the promises of God that have been given. And then we go into this new dimension. And I believe that sometimes it could take our whole life to be able to enter into this dimension, to where it's a dimension of promise, to where we allow God to speak into our lives. And we believe the promises of God because we don't have any other choice. There are no other options. And when the woman with the issue of blood in the Gospels had expired all that she could do, used all of her money, you know, tapped into all the wisdom of the world and was still not healed. But as it mentions in the Bible, she actually grew worse. And so God was her only hope. And so she had said within her heart, if I can just touch the hem of his garment. What would be so amazing is that if we use our daily prayer meetings that happen at Willow Creek and we wake up in a new day, maybe pain, maybe suffering, maybe we're not feeling like ourselves, and we go down and we gather together with prayer and we believe the promise that the Bible says that where two or three are gathered together in my name, that Jesus Christ is there in the midst of that prayer. And then we have faith. Just the faith grain of a mustard seed. And we have faith and we believe God that he is able. Come on, somebody. That's what I'm talking about. And so I believe that you have earned that. I believe that God wants to do that in your life. And I remember Alberta Lambert, who was in your family at Willow Creek at one point. She's 101 years old now. She might be nearing 102. And I don't know if she's even still with us. I saw her right before we went into the COVID-19 lockdown and got a picture with her, and I had her pray for me, just so that y'all know. I had her lay hands on my head and pray a prayer over me, because I believe that's the kind of woman of God she was, and I wanted her blessings over my life. I wanted her to pray over my life, and I am actually keeping the things that she said in my heart, in my mind, because I'm believing God for those things that she prayed. And so but she was an elder in my life, and I really valued her. And I just want you to know that I value every single person that's under the sound of my voice right now. And I thank you, because God values you, and you are here because he wants you to be here. And so I want you to understand and know that, and understand that God is with you and that God is for you. So when I was looking at there, Alberta Lambert inspired faith in my life. I believe that when we spoke the word of faith over Hazel Whitley, one of your residents there, and God healed her. I believe it was because of the foundation of the faith and the acts that were performed within the Willow Creek family that God honored that. I don't think it was anything that I did. I don't think it was because of my walk with God. I wouldn't even consider that. I believe it was because of Alberta Lambert and her faith in God and the way that she impacted that community when she was there. And I believe that every one of you that's sitting here today watching this video have the power to be used of God in this capacity, the power of faith, the power to rise above. What is it that you want to say in these last days? I'm not talking about the last days coming before the Lord. I'm talking about that we are on the threshold, possibly, of crossing over into that promise that God has given us in the scriptures, that if we will believe on him according to the scriptures, that we shall be saved, that we're going to be and we're going to dwell in his presence forever. And that will put us in a place to where that, you know, that, but what do we want to do with our lives? What do we want to do with our lives? I don't want to belabor the point, so I'm moving on. But so he posed this question, Dr. Posh posed this question. He said to the people all over the world, what would you do if you knew you only had 3 to 6 months to live? And he helped people to look beyond the non-essentials to see the real value that was missing from their lives. And he said, if I had 3 words to tell people, it would be tell the truth. I almost taught a Bible study to you today about truth be told. That the truth needs to be told. But first off, the truth needs to be spoken into our lives. We need to speak into our lives the truth of what we know about ourselves. Sometimes, you know, that's why we get caught up in addictions, because we don't want to admit that we're addicted. And so what is it about our lives that we haven't been transparent with ourselves on? What is it about our lives where we haven't been honest with ourselves? That's what we need to evaluate. Maybe write something down, and don't share it with anybody if you don't feel like doing that, but write something down. And then in your time of prayer, talk to the Lord about that thing, about whatever it is that God puts on your heart, whatever it is he reveals to you. Talk to God about those things. Let's rely on God to be our deliverer. Let's rely on God to be our Father, who cares about us. And he would like this cup of suffering to pass from us, but yet it is through suffering that he strengthens, he settles, and he establishes us. And so I don't like suffering just like you don't like suffering. And so my grandson was suffering recently, and it about tore my heart out of my chest. And so, but I got to be honest with you. I had to dive in. I had to dive in and say, God, you know, if my grandson's sick, I want to make sure I'm praying. If my grandson's sick, I want to make sure I'm diving in with my whole heart. I don't want to restrict anything because I can't really imagine my life without him. And so, but it's tell the truth. And he continued saying that if I was going to add 3 more words to that, it would be tell the truth all the time. Tell the truth all the time. And so as I am now past 50. I went past the 50 mark. I'm 51. I'm understanding more and more the value of time. I value my time with my grandchildren. I think that's why grandchildren become special, is because we just value the time that we have. But here's something I don't want you to miss. If you're in the Willow Creek family, I don't want you to miss the value of one another. If you're there, and you're there by God's design, you're there because God wanted you to be there. And honestly, if God has been ordering our steps and you've made all these plans and all these preparations for your retirement, I want you to understand that God was with you in all of that, and that the people that are around you, he wants you to minister to. Because when you minister to them, God's creation, you minister to him. Come on, somebody. You're ministering to him. So I want you to look around the room right now. It may be just one or two of you. It may be 10 of you. But the fact is that look around the room, and those are the people that I want you to share value with. Those are the people that I want you to say, you know, I value you. I thank God for you. And they may be different as night and day from us, but we're together. When you become a part of Willow Creek, you become a part of a family of God, to where not everybody's going to believe in God. That's the great thing about the family of God that's in the earth right now. Not everybody on the earth believes in God. However, if you're sitting here watching this lesson, you believe in God. You're a part of the family of God. Why would I want to listen to this preacher if I'm not a part of the family of God? So you're a part of the family of God, and these people that are around you, God has his love for them is as strong as it is for you. And as much as God wants to see you in his kingdom, dwelling with him forever, he wants that for everybody that's around you. And I encourage you, look at and understand the value of those that are around you. And if you are not okay, if you are not okay, I'm going to say it one more time. If you are not okay, if you're feeling overwhelmed, understand that that's okay. Be honest with yourself. I'm not feeling good today, man. You know, this getting old is not for the weak. Come on, somebody. You know, it's as we do this. I just want you to speak real. I want you to be honest. I want you to speak into your own life and be honest with yourself. And then think about what kind of legacy am I leaving for my family? And so the reality of life is that often it's full of surprises. Come on, somebody. It's unpredictable. And you never know what's coming next. So when we are, and we will be, faced with overwhelming circumstances or overwhelming odds, we have to decide how we're going to look at and assess the situation that we're in. And when you look at life from a human perspective, then you are viewing life through a very narrow lens. When you look at life from humanity's perspective, this is us and how we see God through our eyes. The eyes of a man, the Bible says in the book of Proverbs, are never satisfied. Our eyes are never full. We just want more, more, more. And, you know, it's one of the things I admire about my son, Joshua. He's kind of a minimalist, and I admire that about him. I think that's great. At the same time, I want him to have everything he wants. So I feel like that as a father, that must be how God feels about me. I want him to have everything that he can possibly have. So the human perspective is often bound by the someday syndrome. And the someday syndrome, this is where we play it safe. This is where we settle for far less than what we were made for. It's too many people's favorite day of the week is someday. It's not Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It's not any of that. Someday I'm really going to live for God and I'm going to get my act together. I'm hoping that all the people within under the sound of my voice already have it together. Come on, right? And so someday I'm going to live for God. I'm going to get my act together. Someday I'm going to start loving my family more. I'm going to put my family first. But right now, I got to do this and priorities and come on, right? And someday I'm going to make enough money that I'll spend more time with my kids. But that doesn't guarantee us that they're going to spend time with us. And so that's the thing. It's actually a pretty hard little lesson that I'm learning right now at 51. So someday when I retire, I'm really going to enjoy my life. And so when will we wake up and realize that life is now? You're living your life and your life is now. Now, the thing about it is that a lot of us here today are coming, you know, to the end of our lives. You know, the time that God has given us. If you're over 70, you're living in plus years. As the Bible says, you know, that 70 is basically the promised kind of an average time for the lifespan of man. It's kind of an average. And so we're beyond that. But live your life now. And the thing is that when I'm talking to my elders, and I say this with the greatest and utmost respect, stop feeling like your life is over. Stop feeling like you can't, like you have nothing left to do. You have plenty to do when you look around at the people that God has surrounded you with. You have plenty to do. You have plenty of things to offer. And so think about that and live life now. You know, my father, he died at the age of 67. He was diagnosed with brain cancer. And, you know, God did give us a miracle in that when I found out about the brain cancer, I spoke the word of faith and said, they're going to say what tumor? You know, I declared through faith that they will say what tumor. And, you know, and I spoke that. And then when we went for his surgery in July, in summer, he had a summer surgery. We went in July. I went down to the surgery. They came out after just a few hours of like a very extensive, long surgery, about 2 or 3 hours. And we were really kind of gritting our teeth thinking, man, I think we just lost Dad. But they came out and they said, in all of my years as a neurosurgeon, I have never seen what I've seen today. But when we went in, we didn't find any tumor. You know, there was no tumor. She said it was just liquid. And, you know, where we had seen a tumor, where we thought a tumor was, when we went in, there was no tumor. And so they actually said, there was. So no tumor. And so God did give me the miracle by faith. Now, my father still passed away. But the but one of the things that we did was he was able to come by and see me where I live in Virginia. He grew up and lived in Texas all pretty much all of his life, then I'm assuming. And then but then he came and saw me up in Virginia where I live. I was able to spend some time with him and things of that like that before he passed away. And those are things that I treasure. But one of the things that we captured were video legacy, where my dad can still speak. So I can still pull up a YouTube video today and I can watch my dad and hear his conversation, his old manner. And I can pretty much duplicate. I can kind of imitate it. And when I'm really down in Texas people, I get that kind of a Texas drawl that people get. But thank God, you know, I've been in Virginia long enough. I sound like a normal person. At least I hope. but I want us to wake up and realize that our life is now. Here's what Romans 13 and 11 says this. And that knowing the time, understanding where I'm at, knowing the time, understanding the times is one of the most important things that we can do in our lives, is understand the time. And then that now is, it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. You know, the great thing about it is if I go to be with the Lord tomorrow, then I understand that what the Bible says, when the trumpet of God sounds and the Lord comes back for his church, the Bible said the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then they which are alive and remain shall be caught up to go be with the Lord forever. And so when that day comes and God decides I'm coming back for my church, if I've already gone to be with the Lord, then I'm going to be on the first bus out. But if not, then I'll be on the second group that is alive and remain, and then we'll go be with the Lord together. And so that's why it's so important for us to understand that salvation hasn't passed us by. Salvation and the work of God is still in us, and it's still accomplishing his will. So I've come to you today to ask you to think about your time and the time that you have left on this earth. How are you going to invest that time? How are you going to use that time and bring God glory on a daily basis? And so I'd like to pray about that. I'd like to think about that because I believe that today is your someday. I believe that right now, all of the collective experience of your life can be poured out into maybe a 5-minute video, a 10-minute video, something like that. And I know that Meredith, who serves your family so faithfully, I know that she'll be willing to shoot a video to record something for you or set it up for to make that happen. And so I know that her life is so chaotic and busy. And then she just got married to, I think it was during the COVID-19, if I'm not mistaken. And so, you know, things are this. So the moments are now. Cherish the now moments. Cherish the people that you're around right now. Value them. Let make sure that they understand they have value. And then understand that we're never going to have enough. We're never going to have enough time with our kids, with our families. We're never going to have enough time with one another. And so whatever you need to say in kindness, say it now. If you have something that's unkind, then follow your own advice that you've given to the generation that's coming up after you. If you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all. We got that from you guys. And so let's practice kindness. Let's practice love. Let's practice mercy. Let's practice forgiveness. And let's put those all into practice on a daily basis so that we can enjoy our time together. Because I believe that God has chosen you. And I hope that Meredith, you can work it out to where that you can show the Chosen series, the videos of the life of Christ, where his ministry called Chosen. It's a series. It's available. You can look it up on the web. But that series is powerful, and it will speak to this generation. So listen, thank you so much for joining me today. I pray that, you know, that today has been a blessing for you, and that God will speak to you, that he will minister to you. Thank you so much for being with me today. I went a little over 20 minutes, but I really appreciate your time and the ability to be able to be with you and to speak into your life. Such a great privilege for me. I honor you today as my elders. Thank you for your sacrifices and for the way that you sowed into the economy, and everything that we have today is because of you. And I just want to end our Bible study today saying thank you. Thank you for that. So let's bow our heads and let's have a word of prayer. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, I want to look at my life and I want to see, over these days that I have left on this earth, whatever it is, however much time, whether it be days, weeks, months, or years, I'm asking, Lord, that you get glory out of my life every single day. Lord, help me to see you like you see me, Lord God, and help me, Father, to have a blessing tongue. I want to speak blessing into the lives of those around me. And Father, I'm asking you to give me a love for your word. As I continue to read your word, speak into my life revelation, speak into my life the truth of your word. And God, give me an understanding so that I may have that what is called blessed assurance because of your word. Lord, I thank you, Lord God, that you would help me to learn to reflect, to lift, and to encourage, and to be a blessing to the people that are around me. Get glory out of my life. Again, I pray. And all of those that are my elders, and those that have sacrificed and sown and given us this great, this heritage today, I ask you to bless them and keep them and give them peace. Make your face to shine upon them in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. I sure appreciate everybody. And that's going to end our Bible study together. I hope you have a blessed day, and I will be following up with Meredith for another Bible study. God bless you.